The next type of queue is priority queue. What is priority queue? A priority queue is a special type of queue in which an element is associated with a priority. Each element is associated with its priority and it is served according to its priority. If elements with the same priority enters into the queue, priority queue, then they are served by the rule of queue, that is called FIFO rule. It means that the element which has the higher priority inside the queue will be processed first, and the element which has the lower priority inside the queue will be processed last. Generally, the value of the element itself is considered for assigning the priority to each and every element inside the queue. There are two types of priority queue. First is called as ascending order priority queue, and another is called as descending order priority queue. As the name indicates, ascending order priority queue, in this priority queue, an element having lower value is assigned highest priority. It means that that element will be processed first. The element which has lesser value will be processed first in ascending order priority queue, whereas the element having higher value will be processed last in ascending order priority queue. The another type of priority queue is called as descending order priority queue. In this priority queue, an element having the higher value is assigned the highest priority. That's why that element will be removed first or processed first in the priority queue. And the element which has less priority, or the element which has low value, is assigned lower priority. That will be processed at the last. Just focus on this diagram. Here, if you can see that every element has assigned certain priority. The element which has highest value inside the queue is assigned the highest priority. So if you see this particular queue, this is called as descending order priority queue. This is one of the example of descending order priority queue. If you see that the L9 is assigning the highest priority inside the queue. So I can say that it is the topmost element inside the queue, or which is at the front of the queue. It means that whenever we process or whenever we delete any element from the queue, this element has to be deleted first. Whenever we perform dequeue operation, 9 will be the first element which goes from this queue, priority queue. After that, 4, after 5, then 4, then 3, then 2, and then 1. So when you arrange it in descending order priority queue, first 9 will go out, then 5, then 4, then 3, then 2, and then 1. What is the difference between linear queue that we have studied in the previous lecture and now the priority queue? In simple queue or linear queue, we follow the rule of first in, first out. There, the elements are randomly entered inside the queue. Depending upon the order in which they entered inside the queue, they are processed. So in the first come, first serve manner. Whereas in priority queue, all the values are removed on the basis of their priority. All the elements are processed depending upon the priority assigned to that particular element. The element which has the highest priority will be removed first, and then later the other elements. The element which has lowest priority will be removed at the last. Then we have certain applications of priority queue in real life. Priority queues are used in implementation of dijkstra algorithm. Use this algorithm to find the shortest path between any two vertices inside the graph. Second application of priority queue is for load balancing and interrupt handling in operating system. You will study this concept of load balancing and interrupt handling in the operating system subject. So there we are going to use the concept of priority queue. Then the third application is we use it for data compression in Huffman tree. We have Huffman tree in our syllabus, so we are going to study there how to implement this Huffman tree with the help of priority queue. So priority queue has the application in data compression in Huffman code or Huffman tree. Okay. Now we'll see how to implement a priority queue using array. Till this point, if you have any questions, please ask me. Any doubts, students? In the definition of priority queue, then the comparison between priority queue and the linear queue, types of priority queue, and applications of priority queue. Any questions on this topic? Please reply in the chat. If you have any doubt, you can write your question in the chat room. Have you understood what is priority queue is? Write your answer in the chat. Student, have you understood what is priority queue is? What are different types of priority queue? Okay, I got some answers. Okay, there are no doubts. They understood. Now we'll see how to implement a priority queue using array. The implementation of priority queue using array is somewhat similar to the implementation of simple queue. Only there is a difference between implementation of the NQ operation in linear queue and implementation of NQ operation in priority queue. There is a slight change inside the code, because whenever we insert any element inside the queue, priority queue, it has to be arranged in some order, maybe in ascending order or in descending order. If it is ascending order priority queue, you have to arrange all the data in NQ function in ascending order. If it is descending order priority queue, then you have to arrange that data in descending order in the implementation of NQ function. Okay, so we'll see the implementation of priority queue using array. This is the program for implementation of priority queue. That is descending order priority queue. We are implementing here using array. If you see these lines, first three lines, these are standard lines that we have used in previous program also. This is header file that we need in every program. Has include std.h, has include conio.h, another header file, and has defined max 5. It is the size of the queue. We want to fix the size of the queue because we are using array. So size is fixed. We defined the queue size here as 5. Then we design a structure for queue. This queue consists of two pointers or two variables, that is called front and rear, same as that of linear queue. Then there is an array X which holds the elements of the queue, having the size max, and max defined here is 5. So it means that is X of 5. We can store 5 elements. Then this is a queue variable. Small queue is the queue variable which, by which we can access front, rear, and the array X whenever we need in the code. Before we see NQ operation, I will show you the two functions, that is DQ and display, because the heart of this program is the NQ function. The important function inside the program is NQ function. So we'll focus on NQ function later. That is very, very important function. The code of DQ and display is almost same as that of the implementation of DQ and display function that we have studied in linear queue. Now see, DQ function. Here we are taking a variable that is I. We are checking if q.front is greater than q.rear. Whenever this condition is true, then we can say that the queue is empty. The same condition we have written in linear queue implementation. So same condition is here also. Whenever q dot front is greater than q dot rear, then we can say that the queue is empty. Else, we can say that the element deleted. Where is the element that we are going to delete? It is always at the front of the queue. So that's why we want to, before deleting that element, we want to print it on the screen. So this line is responsible for that. Element deleted equal to percentage d, and it is stored at the location of q, that is q dot x of dot front. So always it will take the first element of the queue, that is the front element of the queue, and it deletes it from the queue. So to delete that element from the queue, I have taken a for loop where I am going to perform left shifting operation. Every next element will be overwritten on the previous elements. See here, for I equal to 0, I less than q dot rear, I plus. Here we are performing the left shifting operation. We already studied this left shifting operation in linear queue DQ operation, DQ function. The same function is here. Q dot x equal to q dot x of I plus 1. X of I is equals to q dot x of I plus 1. It means that we are overriding the immediate next element on the previous element in the queue. So what will happen? The first element is actually deleted from the queue, and the last element is overwritten on the second last location. To ignore that last location value, we immediately write after this for loop, that is q dot rear minus minus. So we are decrementing rear by 1. When the element is deleted, rear should be decremented by 1. When the element is inserted inside the queue, then there we are going to increment rear pointer by 1. So rear value has to be incremented in NQ operation, whereas rear value we are decrementing here by 1 because one element is deleted from the queue. So this works similar to your linear key function. The another function is display. This is also similar to the function that we have studied in linear queue implementation, display function. So before displaying any value from the queue, we will check a condition inside the function, that is if q dot front is greater than q dot rear, then we say that queue is empty. So this is called as queue underflow condition, right? So this is called as queue underflow condition. Whenever this condition is true, we can say that the queue is empty. Else we can say that the queue contains the following elements. We take a for loop, we go from front to rear, and we display every location value from the queue. Then how to write a for loop for that? For I equal to, you can write here q dot front also, that is q dot front is 0 only, or you can say for I equal to 0 semicolon I less than equal to q dot rear semicolon I plus plus. So this loop will go from the beginning of the queue till the rear value, the rear index. It picks the value of array location and it displays on the screen. So there is only one line inside the for loop, that's why I have not written a block here. That is also okay with C programming language. If there is a single line, no need to write a block. So it means that there is only one statement inside this for loop. This will display q dot x of I. So it goes from index number 0 till q dot rear. It displays all the values from front to rear inside the queue. And it stops when it reaches to q dot rear. So this is a simple display function that we have studied in linear queue. Same code is also here. Both the function DQ and display are same as it is. There is only a slight change inside the NQ function. Before going to the NQ function, I will show you how the main program is written. Then we'll focus on NQ operation, how to do NQ operation in priority queue implementation. See, here in main program, I declare two variables N and K. Initially, to tell the compiler that the priority queue is empty, I am assigning q dot front equal to 0 and q dot rear equals to minus 1. Then this template is same as that of the previous program. This is the infinite loop. While 1 means it is infinite loop. Inside the infinite loop, I am showing a menu card to the user. That is, 1 is for NQ, 2 is for DQ, 3 is for display, 4th option is for exit. As soon as the user enters the option, we provide an option value to switch case, and the appropriate case will be picked and it will be executed by the compiler. In case 1, we are going to perform NQ operation. That's why here we are asking the user enter the value that you want to insert inside the queue. That value will be provided to the NQ function. We call NQ function and with the value N. And whenever he comes to the break statement, it exits from case 1. In case 2, we are going to perform DQ operation. we are going to call here dq function, and then when it comes to the break statement, we exit from case 2. In case 3, we are going to perform display function. We are going to perform display operation. So we call display function in the case 3, and then we exit from case 3 whenever we reach a break statement of case 3. Then if the user enters option as 4, we come to case 4, and there is one function we are going to execute. That is, I want to stop the program. For stopping the program, we want to use exit function. So we write exit function in case 4. Then the last option in switch case is default. Whenever the user enters any other value apart from 1, 2, 3, and 4, it always gives an error message that it is invalid choice. Please enter a valid choice. And this is the end of the main program. When it reaches to the gate CS, it stops the main program. Our focus should be on NQ function inside this program, how that function has been written. So as soon as you come to NQ function, user provides a value into the variable N, say he wants to insert N value inside the queue. Then to perform the NQ operation, we are going to use two variables, I and T. T is a temporary variable because we need to do certain swapping, because we need to sort. In sorting, we need swapping. We are going to perform swapping task in bubble sort simply. We are going to use some simple bubble sort in this function. So we have two variables, I and T. There are three possibilities. If Q dot rate equals to max minus one, it means if it is reached to max minus one, your queue is full. So you can just print a message on the screen that the priority queue is full. The another case, maybe the priority queue is empty. How to check priority queue is empty or not? Else if, in the else if, we are going to check another condition. If Q dot rare equals to minus one, then I can say that the priority queue is empty. If priority queue is empty, just directly assign Q dot x of plus plus Q dot rare equals to n. It means that the coming element has to be placed at index number 0 of the queue. The coming element has to be placed at index number 0 of the queue. So where initially we assume that Q dot rare is at minus 1. So in this statement, what is happening? We are incrementing Q dot rare by 1. It means that minus 1 plus 1 becomes 0. That's why this n value will be stored at Q dot x of 0. So I'll write it into the notepad simultaneously. So the element we inserted is 50, where it has been placed? It is placed at index number 0. X of 0 is equals to 50. Now I want to insert another value, that is 30. So we have seen two cases. That is, if the priority queue is full, we're going to display a message that is the queue is full. If the priority queue is empty, then the coming element has to be inserted at index number 0. That becomes the only element inside the queue, priority queue, which will be placed at index of Q dot x of 0. So 50, I want to insert when my priority queue was empty. It becomes the first element. That's why it is placed at index number Q dot x of 0. Now I want to perform NQ operation by which I will insert 30 inside this priority queue. So now if you see here, the queue is not full and queue is having some elements. So we have the third case. So it goes to this else part where we are going to perform this code. We are going to perform another code. There we have to create a space for the coming element. Now you see inside the queue, we have one element that is 50. So as soon as you come to the else part, you will check if for I equal to Q dot rare, semicolon I greater than equal to 0, I minus minus. So I have written this reverse for loop where I'll check a condition if n value, the coming value is greater than q dot x of I. So when I insert the first rear value becomes 0. Correct? It means there is only one element inside the queue. Now this for loop will check I equal to q dot rear, it means I value becomes 0. I greater than equal to 0, I minus minus. It means that this loop will going to execute at least one time. Then we are going to check one important condition, that is the coming element, that is the value n, is greater than the existing value of the q, rear pointer. So q dot x of I value is 0 right now. So we are checking, is 30 is greater than q dot x of 0? Q dot x of 0 is 50. And we found that this condition is false. And we found that 30 is not greater than 50. This condition becomes false. If the condition is false, if the coming element is not greater than the existing element of the queue, we directly go to the else part and we exit from the for loop. We don't do anything. If the coming element, if we found it is less than the existing element of the queue, or it is not greater than the existing element of the queue, just exit from the for loop and assign that value, coming value, add index q dot x of, if you see outside this for loop, we have this statement q dot x of I plus 1 equal to n. So when we exit from the queue, the value of I was 0. When we exit from the for loop, the value of I was 0. 0 plus 1, it means that the coming value 30 has to be inserted at a location 0 plus 1. It means 0 plus 1 is 1. The next value should go into index number q dot x of 1. So I'll write here, what is there in q dot x of 0? It is 50 only. There is no change at this location. But when I inserted 30, I found that it is not greater than the existing element of the queue. I will directly put that element at index number 1, immediate next index after the rear pointer. So here the value 30 will be inserted. When that value is inserted, the rear pointer is incremented by 1 immediately. On the next line, if you see, after inserting that value at a particular location, we immediately increment rear pointer by 1. So here becomes 1. Now we will try to perform LQ operation on this queue by passing some other value. Say I want to insert 80 NQ. I want to insert 80 into this queue. Check how the process of starting is happening here. We are not only inserting the value inside the queue, we are also sorting the queue in descending order. If you see this second step, when we insert 30, the array location 0 has value 50, array location 1 has value 30. So the data is arranged in descending order. Now we want to put 80 inside the queue. So again, it comes to the else part here. The for loop becomes I equal to 1, I greater than equals to 0, I minus minus. Why it is 1, I equal to 1? Because the rear in the last step was I equal to 1, I greater than equals to 0, I minus minus. It means that this loop will going to execute at least 2 times. And then inside the loop, we are going to check the condition. Is the coming element 80 now in this case? If 80 is greater than q dot x of I, what is q dot x of I now? It is 30. We are comparing now, is 80 greater than 30? If this condition is true, then you have to do certain adjustments. We need to create a space for appropriate case, space for 80. We need to shift now 30 to the right side. Then in the next iteration, we'll compare 50 with 80. And again, if 80 is greater than 50, again, you need to shift 50 to the right side. Now, when we entered first time, we found that 80 is greater than 30. That's why we are performing swapping operation here. So what we are doing here, t equal to n, q x of I plus 1 equal to q dot x of I, and q dot x of I equal to t. We are 30 to the right side, and then we are inserting 80 at that particular position. Then in the next iteration, we'll compare 80 with 50, and again 80 is greater than 50. That's why in the next iteration, we will shift 50 to the right side. Then again, I value is decremented by 1. When you perform this twice inside this for loop, I value becomes minus 1. When we exit from this for loop, I value becomes minus 1. And now, when it exit from this for loop, you come to the next line, q dot x of I plus 1 equal to n. So when we exited from the for loop, I value was minus 1. So here it becomes minus 1 plus 1. That is q dot x of 0 is equals to the new element, that is 80. So what is happening here? Q dot x value becomes now 80. X of 0 becomes 80. On the next line, we have q dot x of 1, and that value is now 50. On the next line, q dot x of 2, which has the value 30. After inserting 80, again the real will be given by 1. So real becomes 2 at the end of this operation, NQ 80. How many times you can perform NQ operation? 5 times, because the size of the queue that we have mentioned inside the queue was 5. Now if you see, after inserting 80 here, the queue locations has the values 80, 50, 30, which is arranged in descending order, right? So this for loop is not only inserting a value to its proper place, it also sort the data in descending order. Because we are designing a code for descending order parity, so I have written a condition, this if condition like this. If you reverse this, then you'll get a code for ascending order priority queue. Okay. So like this, we are going to perform NQ operation on the priority queue. I will try to insert 60 so that I come to know how 60 will be inserted in between 80 and 50. We'll again perform NQ operation, say NQ. And I want to insert now 60 inside this priority. What was the rear value we exited from the previous operation? The rear value was 2. Now we'll again come to this else code, else part. There, this for loop becomes I equal to rear, q dot rear. So rear value is 2. I greater than equal to 0, I minus minus. It means this for loop will going to execute 3 times. For I value 2, then 1, and then 0. When it is I value as 2, it allows you to enter inside the queue, and then we are checking, is the coming value, that is 60, is greater than q dot x of I. What is q dot x of I now? It is 30. Q dot x of I is 30. It is the last element of the queue. Rear is pointing to 30. So we are checking, is 60 is greater than 30? If this condition is true, we need to shift 30 to the right side. So by this operation, it allows you to enter inside this if block, and it shifts the value 30 to the right side by one place. Then in the next iteration, I value is decremented by 1. If we are comparing now, is 60, that is n, is 60 is greater than q dot x of I now? When you decrement I value by 1, q dot x of I becomes 1. Q dot x of 1 is now 50. We are comparing 60 with 50. Is 60 greater than 50? And found that the condition is true. It means again we need to shift what? 50 to the right side. So it goes to the if block, it shift 50 to the right side, and then I value is decremented by 1. Now I value is 0. In this case, we are comparing 60 with 80. Is 60 greater than 80? And we found that it is not. It is not greater than 80. So in this case, it immediately goes to the else part. It throws you to the else part, and there we have a break. if the coming element value is not greater than the existing element of the queue, don't do anything. Just break from the for loop and go outside. So when you exited from this for loop, the value of I was zero. The value of I was zero. On the immediate next line, after the for loop, you have the line q dot x of I plus 1 equal to n. It means that the value coming element 60 has to be placed at the index 0 plus 1. I value when you exited from the for loop was 0. 0 plus 1 is 1. And at that particular location, we are going to assign value 60. It means that now q dot x of 1 becomes 60. So I am writing the q position, q dot x of 0 is 80 as it is. There is no swapping done. Q dot x of 1 is now 60. Then q dot x of 2 is 50. And then q dot x of 3 is 30. Now you see, after inserting 30, sorry, after inserting this 60 inside of the queue, rear value becomes 3. Rear is incremented by 1. Right. So here, if you see this queue positions having those values 80, 60, 50, and 30, they are arranged in descending order. So this way we are going to perform the in-queue operation in the priority. There is a slight change. Compare in-queue operation of priority queue with the in-queue operation of linear queue. And that change is that we are not only inserting the value, we are also deciding the position where to insert the value. It means that we are actually performing sorting inside the in-queue operation. If this descending order sorting priority queue, then you have to arrange the data of that priority queue in descending order. If it is ascending order priority queue, then you have to arrange the data in ascending order in that priority queue. So any doubt, students, in in-queue operation, please ask. I will share this PDF. You can try this program at your home later. On any compiler you can execute, it will work. So this is the code for descending order priority queue. It may happen that the examiner may ask you to design a code for ascending order priority queue. Then in that situation, you just have to change only one condition, that is here. Just change this line to make this program for ascending order priority queue. Just change the condition as n less than q dot x of I. Everything as it is. So then that program becomes a program for ascending order priority queue. If you change the condition as if n less than q dot x of I, then this program will become a code for ascending order priority queue. So this ends the concept of priority queue. If you have any questions, students, you can ask now to me. You can write your question in the chat. Any doubt, students, in in-queue operation? Or have you understood the implementation of priority queue using array? We studied a program that is implementation of descending order priority queue. Have you understood, students, the program to implement descending order priority queue? Just reply in the chat. I want to know whether you understood the concept of priority queue. I want the answer from all the students. Write it fast so that I'll come to know, and then I'll switch to the next topic. So you understood, right? So I'll ask you some questions to check whether you understood this concept of priority queue, circular queue, and linear queue. So this ends the second module. We studied all the three types of queue, that is simple queue. Then we studied circular queue. In the last lecture, we studied circular queue, right? And then we studied today the priority queue. The first question to you, all the students, you have to answer me the question within 1 minute. How priority queue is different than other queues, that is circular queue and linear queue? How it is different than circular queue and linear queue? You can write your answer in the chat. How priority queue is different than linear queue and circular queue? You will answer in 1 minute. I want to check who will answer first. Okay, I got first answer from Nainish Rathod. Insertion and deletion operations are different. Okay, Shreya is writing that elements are arranged in order. Very good. Shresh, it removes the elements according to the priority, whether it is higher. Okay, good. Jayesh Chaudhary is saying that elements are assigned priority in priority queue unlike others. Vishal Vishra is writing removes elements based on the priority. Very good, very good. Rutija, in priority queue it is by value and in linear queue it is by FIFO rule. Very good, Rutija. Very nice answer. We follow the FIFO rule in both, that is in priority queue as well as in linear queue. But the thing in priority queue is that we have one additional command, that is we assign a priority to each and every element of the priority queue. We process the priority, the element which has the highest priority first, and we process the element which has lowest priority at the last. That is the difference between priority queue and other queues. What is the difference between circular queue and linear queue? Another question, second question, what is the difference between linear queue and circular queue? So one more point that Shreya Bijam has added, that is if the priority of the coming elements are same, then how they will be processed? They will be processed in according to FIFO rule. The element which entered first will be processed first. Very good, Shreya. So these two points has to be written in the examination if they ask you to compare priority queue with other queues. So the second question that I asked to you is, what is the difference between circular queue and linear queue? And I got two answers. One is from Shreya Bijam. Shreya is saying that circular queue wraps around using mod operation. Very good. But that is about the operation, Shreya. Then Rutija is saying that in circular queue, space can be reused after deleting an element. So this is technically correct. Rutija is right. In circular queue, the space component is very important. The space can be reused after deleting an element, but this will not happen in circular in linear queue. If the space is available and if your rear point is raised to the last location, we are not able to use that particular empty block of linear queue. Patil Vishruta Patil is saying that memory is not wasted in circular queue. Perfect, perfect. Shreyash Parker is saying that in linear queue space is wasted. Good. Bharat Chaudhary comes with the large answer. In linear queue, elements can space cannot be used again. Okay, element deleted whose space cannot be used again. In circular queue, space can be used again and again, so that memory cannot be wasted. Very good, Bharat. Now my third question to all of you. Listen carefully. Third question. What is the empty condition for linear queue? How to check the linear queue is empty, or how do you check the queue underflow condition in linear queue? Very good. I got the first answer from Shreya. Okay. Rituja, both are correct. So whenever front is greater than rear, when this condition comes at any point of implementation of the linear queue, then we can say that our linear queue is empty. All are correct, Srinivas and then Mukti also. Rutuja Nar is also correct. Then the fourth question coming to you is, how do you check the queue overflow condition in the implementation of linear queue using array? Queue overflow condition. Very good, Shreyash. Shreyash has written the answer first. That is, q dot rear equals to max minus 1. Whenever this happens, we can say that the linear queue is full. Another next question. Write a display function. You have to write a code for display function to display all the elements of the queue in linear queue. I want to display all the elements of linear queue. You have to write a code for display function. Small code, 3-4 line code, which will display all the elements of linear queue.